praise the Lord. What are you here for today?
Worship
the Lord of glory. Would you stand on your feet with us this morning? As we begin, let's read a passage of Scripture today as we approach the communion table and as we rapidly approach Good Friday, remembering the work of our Savior on the cross. Amen. Let's read together. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The power of God. You believe in the power of the cross of Christ today? What is the message of the cross? Well, you know, we'll never understand the message of the cross until we understand just how terrible and how serious sin is. Amen? Look at Romans 6:23. Let's read together. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. We're all sinful, aren't we? And that is what we all deserve. We all deserve death. But the cross gives us a way out. The cross gives us an escape. Because Jesus died there as a substitute for sinners. Amen. We don't worship the cross. We worship the one who died on the cross for us. The cross gives. The cross loves. The cross forgives. But the cross demands also. Let's look at one more passage of Scripture, Luke 9, 23 and 24. Let's read together. Then he said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily. And follow me, for whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. As we worship today, ponder that question. Do I really believe in the power of the cross of Jesus Christ? And if I do, what will I do with my cross? Amen.
Yeah.
Please be seated, if you will. And let's sing this next medley together. I come to the cross, near to the cross, and I come to the cross. And Lord God, as we stand before you this morning, worshiping you in spirit and truth, our humble plea, our heart's cry to you today is that you would make us holy, cross-loving.
You.
Stand with us, please. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen.
Bearing all my sin and shame in love. I thank you for coming and coming into this place, pouring your spirit out on us, Lord. Lord, I thank you for just giving us the time to worship you, for you're truly a great God. Lord, I just say thank you for all of that. Lord, and now I just ask that you just be with us. Be with us as we go into a time of communion, Lord, and then a time of worshiping you through our tithes and offerings, Lord, and worshiping you and learning more about you through the sermon, Lord. And so I just ask now that you just again pour your spirit out on us and just help us to get closer to you, Lord. In your name, we pray.
Presentation to give to James, and it comes obviously from the help and strengthening ministry that he's been a part of, and it comes from his church family as well. And what we have here is a one-year chip where James has been drug-free and clean, and the chains that he needs. Be able to present that to you, my brother. 1 year chip. Keep it up. Stay humble before the Lord. Rely on Him. And we're thankful for a good friend standing beside you and Ralph, who loves you and this church loves you. And we're praying for you. And you've got some friends that came today. And these folks here, first time, thank you all for coming. And going to continue to remember to pray and encourage James, say amen.
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 Let's have prayer right now, okay? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this brother in the Lord. We've had the privilege and honor of getting to know him over the years. As in all of life, there's been mountains and there's been valleys. He's humbly come to the altar many times and prayed and let people come around him and pray for him. He's got a great friend here in Ralph Bresler that stood beside him and his family, and they love him, and we love him. He's a part of our church family. And we rejoice in the work of God, and we thank you for the ministry and the work of NA and AA and people that are involved in helping. Enable them, and may they keep their focus on God Almighty. He is the higher power. And in the Lord Jesus Christ, in the power of the Holy Spirit. And may that power continue to surround James, and may he stay humble before the Lord and walk in the path that God lays out for him. And he will be able to give glory and honor to you. In Jesus' name, amen. James, before you sit down, here's what I would recommend you do with that chip if you haven't already. You take that and go to your place of prayer. And you just kneel down. And you present that to Jesus. And you thank him. We'd like to have our servers come forward if they would. We will prepare now for Holy Communion. We remember as they come that our salvation was not purchased with silver or gold or things that are perishable, but our salvation was purchased with the precious blood of Christ. Amen. This morning you do not have to be a member of the church to receive communion. We believe that the requirement is that your faith is in Christ Jesus and that you receive communion with great respect and awe and in reverence that Jesus Christ is your Savior. And while you're waiting for the elements to come to you, be in prayer. Ask the Holy Spirit if there's anything in your life that is not pleasing to Him. And repent of that.
by the grace of God and His help, walk in obedience to Him. And He forgives, cleanses from all sin. And as we shared last week, the teacher stood before her students and she asked those children, is there anything impossible for God? You remember that? And the one child said, raised her hand, and said, it's impossible for God to see my sins through the blood of Jesus Christ. So our faith is in Christ this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Hold the elements in your hand and I will instruct you when to partake.
Alas, and did my Savior weep, and did my sovereign God, would he do that sacred end for sinners such as I?
And then going to the grave and rising again
And his work continues because that day will come when we will be called home to be with him forever. And Lord, our faith and confidence is in you. And as we receive these communion symbols, these elements of the grace and truth and love of God, we pray that we will remember all that you suffered, but also all that you've accomplished, and all that you are still doing and will do. And we will give you glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. This represents the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. Let's eat the body of Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. This represents the blood of Christ, the blood of the new covenant. Let's drink together. Amen. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the precious blood of Christ. Thank you for the amazing love of God. And today, the fellowship and presence of the Holy Spirit. Thank you for the victory won on the cross and with the resurrection from the dead. May we fix our eyes on Jesus, the author, the finisher of our faith. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
At this time, I'd like to ask the ushers to come up. And while they're coming up, I just have a few announcements for you guys. One is a huge thank you from the church and people that are planning the Peru mission trip. The Peru dessert auction raised $1,342 last week. So, again, thank you from the church. That money is going to go and help a lot of people in Peru. And then the other announcement that I have is for the Ladies Sister Act, which is this Tuesday. The ladies group is going to a play at the Broadway Palms Dinner Theater. It's Sister Act. It's Tuesday, March 8th, and they will be at the church at 10:15. They'll be at the church at 10:15 to ride the bus with Denise Main if you're going. We will meet as a group there at 11:30. So meet at the church at 10:15. If you want to ride the bus to go up there, if you're going to go up there on your own, just meet at Broadway Palms Dinner Theater at 11:30. And this is AM, not PM. Just want to clarify that. So then you're there at almost midnight, and then you'll be giving me a call. So again, that's this Tuesday. And it sounds like it'll be a really good fun time, so I strongly recommend for you ladies to be there. Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Lord, thank you again for this day, Lord. And I just say thank you for just giving us this opportunity for us to act. And so, Lord, I just ask now that you just help us as a congregation to live our life through faith and to step out into that faith now, Lord. So I just ask that you just bless these tithes and these offerings now, Lord. And also I ask that you just help us as a church manage and be wise with the funds that you're giving us, Lord, to manage for your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
I first sang this song 4 years ago when I was undergoing breast cancer treatments. And I stand here today cancer-free. I believe every word of this song then, and I believe every word now, and I dedicate this to Krista and Jerry and all others that are undergoing treatments and going through trials in their life. God is still doing great things. Thank you.
Yeah.
Amen. I have a quote in front of my Bible by James Stewart, a Scottish preacher. He says, "In the blackest night, if you open the windows and listen, you will hear the wind, and knowing that God is stirring, never slumbering, never resting, never desisting from his work of providence and redemption, and his cosmic patience is the salvation of the world." God is doing great things. Amen? Praise the Lord. I'd like to invite you to turn in your Bible to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5. The message this morning is how to be an overcomer. We overcome through the precious blood of Christ. Amen. 1 John chapter 5, and I'll be calling your attention to verses 4 through 5. Shall we stand in honor of God's word? 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 and 5. This is the word of the Lord. "For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one that believes that Jesus is the Son of God." Let's pray. We are overcomers through Christ Jesus. We believe in you, Jesus Christ, that you are the Son of God, and you have all power and all authority, and you are filled with the grace and truth of God Almighty. And we learned last week that your rich royal blood, as we believe in you, that blood courses through our veins, and the Spirit of God is in us. The same Spirit, the same power that raised Christ from the dead is alive in us. And we are overcomers through Christ Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Boxing writers and commentaries called it the fight. Many called it the fight of the century. Joe Frazier, the champion, record 26-0, 23 KOs, going against the challenger, Muhammad Ali, record 31-0 and 25 by knockout. The date was March 8, 1971. The place was Madison Square Garden, New York City. Frazier won in 15 rounds with a unanimous decision. Millions of dollars were earned. The play-by-play, the commentator said, "The tension and the hype is so great that it grips the nation." The implications for the fight were political and civil rights movement and various opinions on the Vietnam War. Burt Lancaster, the play-by-play announcer, said, "Just listen to the roar of the crowd. The tension and the excitement here is monumental." There were knockdowns, there were holds, fatigue, there were strong hooks, there were body shots, there were against the ropes, flurries of punches, the roar of the crowd, the clinching, the fight of the century. Those that weren't watching, certainly when they went to bed that night, the first thing they asked in the morning, who won the fight? The fight went the distance, 15 rounds, and the unanimous decision went to those that they called Smokin' Joe Frazier, now became the undisputed heavyweight of the world. When we think of the sports world, we're reminded also that there's other battles in life. There are military forces that oppose each other. They come against each other. And the question, as we look throughout history, who won the war? Who won the battle? We also know that Hollywood has made millions and millions of dollars by framing movies with good versus evil. A great actor recently said he's retiring, Sylvester Stallone, who made lots of money and thrilled many people as the underdog in action movies where the good guy finally beats the evil. The verses that we have before us this morning, they tell us how to win, how to be an overcomer. You see, we make mistakes sometimes when we are converted, when we come to Christ. We sometimes think as long as God is keeping score, I'm there in church on Sunday, and I'll win the battle, and I'll receive a crown, and cross the finish line, and actually it'll be pretty easy. We might say, well, the old Adam nature is gone. I'm a new creation in Christ. I can do this. The reality this morning, when someone enlists in the army, they realize they're just beginning. There's going to be the work. There's going to be the fight. There's going to be the battle. And this is more than the fight of the century. This is the fight of the ages. Listen again to these verses. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. And I remind you this morning that our salvation is a free gift from God. And it's as free as the air that we breathe. And we're breathing some pretty nice air right now down here in southern Florida, aren't we? There's no gold or silver that could purchase the precious blood of Christ. Our salvation is a free gift. We can't earn it. We don't deserve it. And we're thankful for the grace of God. Amen? On the other hand, Jesus tells us that to follow Him, we will have to pick up a cross. There will be a cost. We will have a battle. We will have to work. We will sweat. We will cry. We will struggle. We will mourn. We will say as Jesus, my God, why have you forsaken me? We will say as Job, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. We will say, even if we're not cured of that terminal disease or that sickness or whatever it is, we will say, I still trust God. When you can't trace God's hand, you can trust His heart. God is good all the time. All the time, God is good. We sang together last week, you're a good, good Father. Salvation is a free gift. It is wonderful. It is amazing, the amazing grace of God. But we are in the battle of the ages. When I was a boy going to church camp, St. Mary's, Ohio, and I'm thankful for the women in the church, because when we gathered under that tent, there weren't any male leaders. The women were leading the children. We need men to help lead children. Amen? Many men need to be mentoring younger men. You men that are here, no matter how old you are, you have something to offer. You need to be mentoring a younger man. Did you hear that? You need to be mentoring a younger man. There's a lot of younger men, and James will tell you, there's a lot of younger men, if some other men would have gotten their face when they were young, and would have mentored them and held them accountable and loved them and prayed for them and met with them regularly, the outcome would be different. Should be a lot of amen to that. Amen. When I was a boy going to that camp in St. Mary's, there were lots of ladies and they came and worked with the children. And I remember going under that tent as a boy. And those ladies taught us a song, I'm in the Lord's army. They also had a sing in camp meeting, Onward Christian Soldiers. The church used to be more militant, and I don't mean militant with the weapons of the world. Our weapons are not carnal. Our weapons are not the weapons of military and the weapons of hate. They are weapons of love and truth and righteousness and compassion and the mercy of God. But we have lost that militant desire to go against the enemy and to fight and to battle because we are in the battle of the ages. Turn, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I begin reading at verse 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 11. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. Did you hear that? The foundation is Jesus Christ. Foundation is not built on many religions and many paths to heaven. The foundation is built and laid by one man, the Son of God, and his name is Jesus Christ. Let me read on. If anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, their work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. We may be saved by the grace of God, but our work, our faith in God, the battle that we are in, one author said, we may be saved, but only by the skin of our teeth. The great preacher, Dr. D.L. Moody, said this, and I quote, I believe a great many men will barely get to heaven as Lot got out of Sodom, burned out, nothing left, works and everything else destroyed. End of quote. When you join the army, you are a member of the army just like the man that has been in the army for 20 years. But when you join the army, you don't know what that man of 20 years knows about the army, do we? See, if we join the army and fight in our own strength, we will get beat. We will lose in our own strength. You know that, don't you? I was counseling someone recently and giving them principles from the Word of God. If you think I'm talking about you because you're here this morning, you never know, because pastors actually do more counseling than anybody else in the country. And the pastors are major counselors. And someone say, what's your qualifications? Along with courses, along with various forms of certification and training, this is our foundation. And as I was counseling, I was giving the principles that would bless and help the life of the one I was counseling. And I said, now you can try to work these principles. You can try to work this as a system. You can try your very best and just put every single bit of effort that you can into this. But I'm sorry to say, you will fail. The only way that you'll be an overcomer and apply these principles is through the power and the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. You see, if we do it in our own strength, we'll lose the battle. That's part of our problem, isn't it? That's why the church gathers on Sunday morning. And aren't you glad we can come together and get our eyes off our problems? And we can join in and we can worship the Lord and get our eyes on the one who is greater and stronger and more powerful than the enemy or the culture or whatever presses against us. God is greater. And we can dwell on that and worship Him and sing to Him and realize that we are overcomers through Christ Jesus. When we think of overcomers, I must mention the martyrs. You are aware that what you see of attacks by Muslims, and you hear about Boko Haram, and you hear about various movements within Islam
What is often not reported is that the majority of those attacks are against Christians. This is a recent version of the voice of the martyrs in a story that I would read to you about overcoming faith. Listen to this. When Boko Haram fighters stormed Regina Wilson's village on October 24, 2014, she was ready to meet them. For several years, she had heard stories about them and their brutal attacks on Christian villages in northern Nigeria. She knew, therefore, that her village, just south of this terrorist group stronghold, could easily become a target. I once thought that even if I should be captured by Boko Haram, I will never deny my faith in Christ Jesus, she said. So when we met them, my mind was made up beforehand, since I know who I serve. I got more to read here. But when I read this, early in the morning I was so humbled, because I was in the presence of an overcomer as I read this. I go on, one by one, the attackers ask villagers if they were Christian or Muslim. Along with many others in the village, Regina and her family boldly declared their faith in Christ. The fighters then promised them that if they would turn to Islam, they would be given a hijab as a sign of their new faith. When they refused to speak, Regina and her four children, ranging in age from 8 to 18, were abducted and taken to a nearby house. They also took three of her sister's children who were with them when the attack occurred. We did not respond, Regina said. Our attackers grabbed us and took us to a house and started preaching Islam, that what we were being told in churches is not true, that Christianity is a false religion, that Islam is the only true religion. The preaching continued, but we uttered no word. I only remembered what Jesus told Peter. Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times, and it encouraged me not to deny Jesus like Peter did. Less than 24 hours after the abduction, Regina watched Boko Haram fighters kill three men, including her oldest son, 16-year-old Hayelda. They were given no chance to convert. They slit his throat with a machete, Regina said. One of my neighbors was among the three men killed at that time. They were slaughtered like rams. Boko Haram had terrorized northern Nigeria for more than 13 years. And since the leader there had gained control in 2009, the group has slaughtered an estimated 17,500 people, mostly Christians. As Regina recalled her son's death, the emotions returned. At that moment, I felt so bad, she said. I almost became mad. I felt some mental imbalance. I felt that it affects me mentally, but with prayers, I am coping well and getting better day by day. Although Hayelda was taken from her, Regina thanks God that her son knew Christ. After abducting the Christians, Boko Haram fighters confiscated everyone's cell phones, but a young woman who lived with Regina's family managed to hide hers under her clothes. After Hayelda and the other men were killed, she secretly called a friend in the Nigerian military. She gave him their location and explained the situation, and her friend promised to send help. Within a day, a military helicopter attacked the compound, killing three of the 10 Boko Haram fighters who had been guarding the Christians from Regina's village. In addition, many other militants as well as their captives suffered serious injuries in the attack. All of us fainted, Regina said of her family. All of the children were hurt. Regina's 8-year-old son, Praise, was blinded in one eye. And her 12-year-old son, Wadia, suffered injuries to his hands and legs and his eyes. Her niece, Evelyn, lost her right leg in the attack. A lot of innocent people died, she said. Regina was greatly distressed at the sight of the injured children. She had already lost a son, and Praise's eye injury caused her additional pain. My heart bled, she said. I gave birth to a healthy child, but because of Boko Haram, my child will now live without an eye. In the chaos, she even said goodbye to Wandia, who believed he was dying from his injuries. Juan Diaz said I should pray for him and that I should leave him behind to die so that I can escape with the other children because the injuries he sustained were so bad, she said. I prayed with him and we left. Regina prays and the other survivors walk for 2 days to reach the nearest hospital. After Nigerian soldiers rescued Juan Diaz and others, the family was reunited in a refugee camp. Regina said that even if she had known what would happen to her family, she still would have told Boko Haram that she was a Christian. She struggles to forgive them, however. As a Christian, I will forgive them, but it's not easy to forget, she said. Because God said, if some hurt you, you should forgive that person. So I have forgiven them, but to forget will be too hard. Regina is still mourning the death of her oldest son and the innocence stolen from her remaining children. Her oldest daughter, 18-year-old Peace, is still missing. As with many young girls abducted by Boko Haram, she may have been married off to one of their fighters. As a result, I am almost paralyzed because of so many thoughts running through my mind, Regina said. Taking a deep breath, she continued. My faith is strong. I am strong in the Lord. I will keep trusting Him more and keep holding on to Him. Wow. In our own strength? Never. In the strength of Christ, believing in Him, we can be overcomers through Christ. Christians who have been in the battle, I remind you, many think that we can just drift right into heaven, just catch a current and drift. Or maybe we can float on some celestial cloud of grace. Or maybe our halo will carry us into heaven. You know, we would rather be on the battlefield and be bloody. And in the world's eyes, lose. And never denounce our faith in Christ Jesus. I would rather be on the battlefield bloody, fighting, giving my all, than thinking the Christian life is a bunch of warm fuzzies and it's all good. It's not all good. We are in the battle of the ages. Jesus told his disciples, stay here, watch and pray. And then he went and sweat drops of blood because he was under such anxiety and pressure, and the disciples fell asleep. I remind you this morning that Christian life is a conflict. It is a battle. If your faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are in warfare. In Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20, tells us to put on the whole armor of God. You see, with man, this is impossible. With man, this is impossible. We will be knocked down. We will be destroyed. But with God, all things are possible. When we are linked with Christ Jesus, we are overcomers. When we are linked with Christ Jesus, when the seed of the gospel falls, it doesn't hit the path where the birds get it. It doesn't hit the rocky ground where it's shallow and there's no root and it withers away. When we are linked with Christ Jesus, it's not among the thorns choking it out. It hits the good soil and multiplies 30, 60, 100 times what is sown. Frederick Douglass, the great slave orator, he gave a mournful speech. He said, these are dark times for the Negro. And he said this, and I quote, the white man is against us. Governments are against us. The spirit of the times is against us. I see no hope for the colored race. I am full of sadness. End of quote. Just then, a poor old black woman rose in the audience and she said, Frederick, is God dead? I remind you,
With man, this is impossible. With God, all things are possible. We look at the odds. We look at the battle. We look at our culture. Our culture and our media makes us focus on what is wrong. We look at people that are in the struggle and they get beat down. But aren't you glad to know that whatever is coming against us, as I heard one presidential prospect say at the end of his speech, and I say it representing God, God says, I got your back. I got your back. With man, this is impossible. With God, all things are possible. I look out across the congregation. You're in the battle. You're in the good fight. And some of us, we get real bloody and we get knocked down. And Satan is after you. When Satan comes to me with doubts, here's how it goes. The thought comes to the mind that says, there's a conflict there because you have failed. And then the one failure becomes 5 and 10 and 20. And I sit there and mull it over. And if I let the enemy beat me up, I will just arise and say, it's all done, I'm a failure. But if I claim through Jesus Christ the power of God and pray and put my eyes on Jesus, I am an overcomer. The fiercest attacks come against the strongest of forts. The harder the battle is probably because you're on the verge of a great breakthrough. When you hit the mat, in the great fight of the ages, and the doctor gives you certain news, and I pray for you that have heard that news, I pray for you every day by name. I don't know what's going on in your life if you don't tell me. But I pray for you when you tell me by name. And when the doctor gives you news, and it looks like your family's falling apart, and there's financial need and struggle, and you hit the mat, I want you to be reminded this morning that you trust in a triune God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit that will never leave you. 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The only man who ever conquered this world in the battle of the ages was Jesus Christ. And on the cross, as our Savior there fighting the battle, when he said the words, it is finished, it wasn't with a meek, lowly voice of loss and despair and getting beat. When Jesus said it is finished, it was a voice of victory and overcoming and power and glory and honor. And when Jesus said those words, it was a triumph call that the battle is won. It is finished. Amen. Jesus Christ won the battle. We need to be conquerors through Christ. Whatever Satan brings at us with full force. And he hit Christ with everything that he had. And he sucked the precious blood and life out of Jesus Christ. But I remind you that Christ won the battle. And his Spirit lives in you as believers. And when everything human fails, which everything human does fail, countries come and go. Kingdoms come and go. Powers come and go. Technology breaks. Things rust
and fade and get stolen and movements come and go. But as a Christian, we should never get our eyes off of God, because when our eyes off of God, we can fail. Abraham failed. Moses failed. Peter, when he got his eyes off of Jesus, he sank down into the water. If you look at the biblical greats, the area where it seemed like they had the strongest character is the area that they fell in. Whenever they took their eyes off of God and trusted their own power and their own goodness and their own strength and their own ability, that is the area where they failed. Listen, Peter, he was a big, tough, bold guy. But we find a servant girl coming to him and say, "Aren't you one of his? I don't know him," and denied him 3 times. If only that servant girl could see Peter stand up on the day of Pentecost. And he preached the word of God with power and proclaimed the word of God, the gospel with power, and thousands of people were saved. We have to keep our eyes on Christ. And when our eyes are on Christ, we can win the victory. Galatians 2:20 says, "I am crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but the life I live by faith in Jesus Christ." That means Christ who died on the cross. That means however tough, however much suffering, however much difficulty, and I remind you, you have a terrible enemy to contend with. The Bible says he's like a roaring lion, looking to see who he may destroy. If you're in a battle, if you're in a trial, that might mean you're right where you're supposed to be. And God's about to do something amazing. And when you get your eyes off of him, you'll fail. But if you keep your eyes on Christ and your faith in Jesus Christ and in his victory, and you realize that you are a child of God Almighty, and you can cry out, "Abba, Father, Father, help me," and "Holy Spirit, be help me," and you claim the word of God. When Jesus was tempted 3 times by the enemy, he responded with these 3 words, "It is written." One of the ways the enemy is seducing and working against the church and our culture is to get us away from our moorings, to get us away from what is absolute truth. I still believe that truth is what God says, and what God says is here in the Word of God. And truth does not change, because God does not change. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Cultures change, people change, moods change, movements change. God is the same. His Word is the same. And he said, "It is written." The war is on. I will say to you, if you're not in the battle, if you're not throwing punches, if you're not putting up your defense, if you're not grappling with the enemy, then you are spiritually dead. But if you're fighting, and you're aware that the enemy's trying to come against you and your family and what you want and the dream that God has given to you. You see, the enemy comes against me and the things that I vision and dream for this wonderful church and says that will never happen. He even told me this week, "That's a pipe dream." No. In the name of Jesus, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. The war's on. There's many people that are Sunday morning Christians. Sunday Saint and Monday Ain't. If you want to know what kind of person they are and how they're in the battle, you go home and ask their spouse. You ask their family. You go to where they work. A sign of a great church is not attendance and the size of the buildings and the size of the offerings. The sign of a great church is what happens when the benediction is said and that church goes out those doors and is the salt and the light and represents the power and strength of God Almighty. Many of us sanctimonious on Sunday, tempted and failed on Monday. A Sunday religious thing. And we think as the week goes on, it'll all be warm fuzzies. Uh-oh. The battle is on. But the scripture tells us, and I repeat it again, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. If you don't hear anything else from this preacher, you hear this. Fix your eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith. And don't take your eyes off him. You're overcomers through Christ. Amen. And we're going to close. I'd like to invite you to bow your heads. I appreciate so much your respect and reverence. All heads bow. Somebody, the battle is pressing a little bit harder and it's just overcoming you. Satan's attacking your fort. He's attacking your dreams. He's attacking your family. Your eyes have gotten off Christ and you've tried your own strength. And you, like even the greats of the Bible, have failed. If you would like to put your eyes on Christ, keep your eyes on Christ, and believe that he is the Son of God, claim his power and strength in your life, I would invite you to lift your hand to him. Lift your hand right where you sit. Yes. Yes. Keep the hand up for a moment so I can see those hands. You can lower your hands. Gracious Lord Jesus Christ, you know the battle well. You walk this earth, dusty feet, very long days. The enemy came to you in person and showed you all the kingdoms of the world. He said, if you'll just bow down to me, you can have all of these. He told you to turn these stones into bread. He told you to jump off the temple. Ask your angels to catch him. Jesus, you said, it is written. You didn't go by feeling. We're not asking for a church where there's great feeling and warm fuzzies. We're asking for a church that's built on the faith and on the foundation of nothing else except Jesus Christ. Not signs and wonders, but Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for those who lifted their hands. They're in the battle. We're all in the battle. We feel it and sense it and know it. And you, our Savior, are the one that walked this earth and you fought the battle. Thank you, Lord, and we claim that. And those that lifted their hands to you, may we claim the words of Christ on the cross. It is finished. The battle's won. And that victory was validated when Christ busted out of the grave on the third day and is risen and offers the gift of eternal life. God has never stopped working. We don't put our faith in a presidential candidate or a certain movement or powers and monies of this world. Our faith is in Jesus Christ. Lord, may we fix our eyes on you, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And there is Jesus. We look to him now. The Bible tells us he is ever interceding. I remind you, congregation, and those who lifted their hands, Christ Jesus is praying for you. Christ Jesus offers you the victory in his power and in his strength. And through his word, you will be an overcomer by faith in the Son of God. It's in his name we pray. Amen. God bless you.